When you love something, I think it just happens gradually, and it just happens without you even knowing it.
In February 2005, Christina Aguilera and her boyfriend Jordan Bratman took a trip up the California coast.
So we went up to Carmel, and while we were having dinner, I had the manager just completely fill the room with balloons.
Pink and red balloons, which are my favorite colors. And he had planned this elaborate scavenger hunt around the room.
She had to kind of go around finding all of these little gifts. The last clue was that she had to come over to me, and then I got on one knee, and I had hidden the ring underneath the couch, and I pulled it out and presented it to her.
Stephen Webster's name was on the box, which is my favorite jeweler, so I thought, you know, earrings, necklace, something, and I open it, and my jaw drops, and I immediately start tearing up, and I just was completely taken by surprise, and I was so shocked and excited and hysterical that Jordy was like, so what? You haven't answered me yet. What is it? What's the answer? And then, of course, I was like, of course, yes.
And we actually both started crying when I proposed to her. It was just beautiful. It was great. It was perfect.
So it was an amazing moment in my life.
That November, Christina and Jordan married in an elaborate 3-day celebration at a Napa Valley vineyard.
The first night we had a little cocktail party just to kind of welcome all of our guests.
They were so happy. Christina and Jordan wanted to share that with everybody.
The second night, rehearsal dinner before our wedding was a Japanese theme.
The menu was all Asian inspired, and they had cute little names for the cocktails, and then everyone had to dress in Japanese costume.
And then the next day was the actual wedding.
They had a really wonderful ceremony. They had decorated this beautiful tent as a Roman cathedral, but they exchanged vows, traditional Jewish vows.
I come from a family of Holocaust survivors, and I think it was just important for me just to honor the tradition of a Jewish wedding, and Christina was totally fine and open with it.
Those seconds leading up to the walk, I was just so emotional.
It was really sweet. It was one of those, like, wow, I can't believe I'm getting married. She just couldn't believe this moment in her life had come.
And when the curtains opened and revealed Christina, it was just breathtaking to see her in the dress, and she looked just so beautiful. And it was just really a very emotional experience for me to know that that was the moment that we'd been waiting for.
I was to meet both the moms at the end of the aisle, my mom on one arm, his mom on the other, and then they would walk me the rest of the way to my husband, Jordan, at the end.
I never expected to be asked to walk my daughter down the aisle, but she's had so much in her lifetime, you know, that happened with her father. You know, there's a lot of pain.
It was emotional for me to realize that this is where I'm headed to in the next chapter of my life, and in starting a family of my own. And this is the step I make towards not repeating where I was when I was a little girl, because I knew I was marrying an amazing man who I would never feel that experience or that turmoil, that chaos that I was grown up with.
He's the world's greatest guy, and the smartest thing Christina ever did is marry Jordan.
Aguilera wasted no time getting back to the studio to finish her third album.
By the time I came to recording Back to Basics, I'd fallen in love, I'd experienced so many new things, come to terms with a lot of my past, and was able to let a lot of things go. I felt probably lighter emotionally, and well, when you feel lighter emotionally, you're gonna reflect that on the outside.
I do definitely think that from Strip to Back to Basics, it's more of her maturing as a woman and an artist and finding a different way to express herself.
Back to Basics was different than her other albums in the sense that it had this retro feel to it.
I knew that I was going to want to make a record that really touched on the great soul singers and jazz musicians and artists of the 20s, 30s, and 40s.
Etta James and Billie Holiday were two of her favorites. She related to the pain she heard in the songs.
The whole idea of kind of going back in time to meld, you know, hip-hop and current-day R&B with, you know, kind of older, more traditional forms of music.
I wanted to get in touch with the roots of what inspired me to start singing in the first place.
Released on August 15th, 2006, the album debuted at number one.
No Other Man was the first single from that record to kick it off with high energy, praising the good men in life, which Jordan will always be.
When you take it on a universal level, everyone can relate to it that's been in love. When they find that person, you know, there's nobody on this planet that's like you.
I was happy and in love, and I had this new, you know, lease on life. So Ain't No Other Man was definitely the result of me feeling I'd finally found an amazing man in life, which I'd never known before.
It was obviously really exciting. From her last record, we had gone through all of these life experiences together, so it was just fun to hear what that turned into musically for her. And she wrote that song with DJ Premier, who's one of my all-time favorite producers.
Christina just walks in and says, okay, I'm ready, and belts it out pretty much in, you know, one or two takes. You know, she just nails it. And then we're done. And I mean, it was actually easier than I thought, because I've never really worked with a pop artist. I'm used to hip-hop artists, so the whole process is a little bit different.
She was one of the most technically perfect singers I've ever worked with. So as a writer, it was extremely inspiring to work with her, because if you could dream it, she could sing it.
At the 2007 Grammy Awards, Ain't No Other Man was a winner.
What did you win, tell us?
Best Female Pop Vocal, so I'm really, really excited.
Christina, God, he has Grammys stacked on the wall, so this is just another one to add onto the belt.
During the ceremony, Aguilera performed It's a Man's World in a special tribute to R&B legend James Brown.
And she loved the idea, very excited about it. I remember the fittings for the wardrobe, and she learned some of the James Brown exact moves.
I remember speaking to her and telling her how important it was to completely destroy that song, because there was talk, you know, she didn't seem like the right candidate to pull off a James Brown song. And I remember she and I having to talk about it, and she was like, don't worry, I'm gonna kill it.
It was just one of those magic moments that only an artist of her ability can create, and she just nailed it. You know, she nailed it live. I remember I was backstage, she walked off the stage and she walked up to me and said, I nailed it.
I'm like totally crying. Wow, okay, sorry, cut.